I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little
beloved, we are gathered today to pay our final tribute of respect to that which was mortal of our deceased loved one and friend, Mrs. Lydia Spencer. Lita Spencer. To you mourn members of the family who mourn your loss, we especially offer our deep and sincere sympathy. May we share with you the comfort offered by God's word for such a time as this. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am." Jesus also said to his disciples, to Mary and Martha, when they lost their brother, Jesus turned to these two sisters of Lazarus and said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever believes in me will never die." Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we come into this sanctuary of sorrow, realizing our utter dependence upon you. We know you do love us and can turn even the shadow of death into the light of morning. Help us now to wait before you with reverent and submissive hearts. You are our refuge and strength, O God, a very present help in time of trouble. Grant unto us your abundant mercy. May those who mourn today find comfort and healing balm in your sustained grace. We humbly bring this petition in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. We are going to have a reading now.
I just want to thank Titi for allowing me to read this, and Pastor for choosing the Psalm 23 for us today. I believe it's a psalm that my aunt reflected in her life. I'm going to read it, and then I'll just give you a little reflection of what I think of it. Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Well, I believe that my aunt is dwelling in the house of the Lord forever right now. The other day, someone called me and told me to give me the condolences. And she said, I never get the chance to talk to your aunt. But all the time I saw her, she was a calm person. Well, that's how I remember my aunt, as a calm person. And that calmness cannot come from her. That calmness comes from God, from her Lord. I'm sure she made her Lord her shepherd, like David said. I never saw my aunt lacking anything. David didn't said about lacking material things. He was talking about the presence of God. My aunt always had the presence of God with her. She attended church all the time. My encouragement for all my family today is to love the Lord. Make God your friend, your shepherd. He will lead you. And he's the one who can give you that comfort that you need.
Amen. sister in Christ, Mrs. Lita Spencer, came to Jesus because of God's grace. And the word of God says the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all who believe. And it is by grace that we can be saved. Let us sing God's grace, amazing grace. How sweet the sound.
Lydia Texera Spencer, 82, of New Bedford, passed away peacefully on Sunday, August 7th, 2022. She was the wife of the late Carlos Spencer. Born in Brava, Cape Verde, daughter of the late Manuel Ramos and Natalia DePina Texera, she lived in New Bedford most of her life. Lydia was a loving wife, mother, and grandmother. She loved to cook and spend time with her children and grandchildren. She was a longtime member of the International Church of the Nazarene, where she enjoyed singing in the church choir and the fellowship she had with all the other church members. Lydia worked at St. Luke's Hospital before her retirement. Survivors include her son, Attilio Spencer of New Bedford, her daughter, Octilia Tavaz, and her husband, Derek, of New Bedford. Her brothers, Jose Cabral and João Neves, her sister, Manuela Almeida, and her grandchildren, Simone and Spencer Tavaz, and Isaiah and Ty Spencer, and many nieces, nephews, close friends, and relatives. I'd just like to say a few words about my mom. She was one of the best people you could be lucky enough to meet. Anyone that met her was always welcomed by her beautiful smile. You would never leave the house hungry. Her gufón, cachupa, and jag were the best. I'm sure all of you've had a taste of that. As her health started to decline several years ago, it was clear that we as a family had to step in and help because she was always, always there for us, no matter what. I'm not going to lie, it wasn't always easy, but with the help of my husband, Derek, we always managed. By the way, I'd like to take a quick moment to thank him for all that he's done for us. Speaking of the men in the family, my brother, Bubboy, we all know was her favorite, let's be real, was always a mama's boy, was by her side till the very end. There isn't anything that he wouldn't have done for her. I know it's cliche, but it does take a village. Jody and Iris, you are always going to be a special part of our family. We appreciate everything you've done for us and for Vovo. She knew and loved you guys dearly. Lastly, Vovo's grandchildren were her pride and joy. She loved them dearly. Isaiah, Ty, Simone, and Spencer, you will always have a special part and a place in her heart. Never ever forget that. She was proud of each and every one of you. Vovo is now reunited with Papa Keji and is with the Lord, and knowing that gives me peace inside. She is no longer suffering. Love you and miss you, Ma.
My sister must have read some of what I was going to say, but that's okay. That's okay. thank you all for coming today to celebrate my mother's life. I would also like to thank everyone who in the past few days sent messages of condolences and sympathies. They have been comforting during this difficult time and have been a reminder of the impact my mother had on so many. Before I continue, I'm going to go off script a little bit because there were so many memories that I wanted to share about my mother, but I know, you know, time is of the essence. We have to feed you later, you know, so. like how beautiful she was and how she never seemed to age. How I loved teasing her when we went to church because she always had to wear dresses and shoes with heels, even when she couldn't walk in them anymore. She was confiada, you know, a little diva. And I would always ask her, did you come to see Jesus, or did Jesus come to see you? I also loved how she used to call my brother-in-law Derek instead of Derek. Or when we would sometimes ask her a question, she would always answer, yeah, sure. Iris particularly loved that response. I could go on and on, but I regress. My mother was a caring, loving person who never asked for anything but always gave of herself. That was especially true when it came to me and my sister Titi. She was a stay-at-home mom for most of our childhood, who had spent a lot of her time alone with us because of my father, her husband, Papa Kaji, spent several months away working hard to support us. We were very lucky to spend all that quality time with our mother. Sorry. But after this past weekend, it feels as though all that quality time still wasn't enough. My real name is Octilio, and while most call me either Tilly or Boboy, thank you, Pastor. My sister found it necessary to come up with her own special nickname for me, which she happened to mention earlier. A nickname I personally find very endearing. That name, of course, is Mama's Boy. Maybe she called me that because my mother always had to make sure I ate something, Or maybe it was because my mother found it necessary to make my own special plate of food because I'm such a picky eater. There could have been many reasons for the nickname because of how selfless my mother was. Whatever the reason for the nickname, all I can tell you is that I am so very lucky to have been Lita's mama's boy for 47 years. She loved her family, church family, friends, and based on all the countless conversations I've had the past few days, I know those same people loved her just as much. She was an active member of this church. She sang in the choir, cooked, and helped out whenever there were church functions. She would even put out those little communion cups in the trays every month for Communion Sunday. She would do anything she could to help the church. I remember one day about 6 years ago when I was in the car with my mother in front of the house. She started telling me a story about how she went out with a friend and her friend told her she saw on the news that I had murdered someone. I, of course, laughed and thought her friend must have just mistaken me for someone else because I'm obviously not a murderer. While the story might have sounded funny at the time, it ended up being a story that dramatically changed my mother's quality of life from that point on until her passing. Vovolita no longer seemed to be the Vovolita we always knew and loved. She started telling more stories, which became more and more bizarre. There were no more of her helping at the church or helping anyone for that matter. No more cooking, no more happy, smiling Vovo. All that seemed to disappear so quickly. It was so sad and scary to see the drastic change to my mother's life and her personality. My mother was eventually diagnosed with dementia, but that in itself did not make it easier for her or any of us. It sure wasn't a cure because there is no cure for dementia, but there was hope. There's always hope with God, right? Mm-hmm. With the help of my ex-wife, Jody, thank you, Jody, we were able to get my mother help at Butler Hospital. After she was admitted there for a few months, released and readmitted again for a few more months, we seemed to regain a little bit of the old Vovo back when she got back home. The bizarre stories seemed to disappear, and after some time, it seemed that Vovo was only dealing with short-term memory loss and a lack of wanting to do anything. Who could blame her for the latter? Even still, it seemed nothing short of a miracle. Fast forward to May of this year, my brother-in-law Derek, found my mother, I believe it was on Saturday morning, lying on the floor next to her bed, not saying anything. My mother somehow fell, and unfortunately, it was just what wasn't bruises that the hospital found she had after the fall. There was also a benign tumor just beneath her skull, which was eventually removed shortly before her passing. The dementia and the fall became too much, and her quality of life quickly declined again, declined to a point where she only spoke a few words, if any at all. While I'm telling you all this to give you a picture of what my mother was going through the last several years, I am also telling you this because I want you all to know there is hope for anyone going through a situation, any situation for that matter, with God, family, and friends who care and reach out to support, there's always hope. Fortunately for my mother, she had a lot of people in her life that loved and care enough to reach out and help her any way they could. Like Jody, who again helped us get my mother into Butler Hospital, or her friend B. King, who came down to stay with her when she found out about my mother's condition, or her neighbors, the best neighbors in the world, Frank and Roland, who always guided her guided my mother back home when she would walk out of the house. Or Iris, who was always around to help my mother and the family any way she could. Or my brother-in-law, Dirik, who was always there to help my sister take care of my mother. Or Lottie and Raquel, who did all they could to get my mother the right doctors and hospitals after she fell. I could go on and mention so many others who did so much for her, but I'll stop there and just simply say thank you. Thank you all for the love and support you gave my mother. It will never be forgotten. Simone, Spencer, Isaiah, and Ty, if you see me out there in Kenya, I want you to know that Vova loved all of you so much. And even though we will always miss Vovo, because she physically isn't with us anymore, she will always be right here in our hearts. Finally, I want to leave you all with a short verse, which I believe is a reflection of the life my mother lived, but I hope at the same time it will give each of you a better perspective of our own individual journey through this life. The verse is short and simple. It's Philippians 1:21. To live is Christ, and to die is gain.
Amen.
Or in other words, Vova Lita had a Christ-filled life on earth, and because of that, she now gained a life with Christ in heaven.
Amen.
While we mourn because she is not physically with us anymore, we rejoice she's in heaven where there is no more pain or suffering. Thank you all, and God bless.
Amen. I do not know if there is a member of the family who would like to come and want to share some remembrance. Please, family or friends.
I actually prepared a script, and I wanted to share it when I read it, but I chickened out. I was afraid to share it. Many times, as I said earlier, my aunt, I know her as a calm woman. I never saw my aunt sad or mad. And she always had a smile. And I'm going to say this in Creole. Me era orgulhosa de tinha tia no Bedford, bonita, amada minha tia. Tudo alguém que vem de Cabo Verde. Onde trazia no Bedford, para ver onde minha tia é bonita. When I was younger, I used to come sleep with her on weekends. That time, there was no cell phones. I used to show up uninvited, unnoticed, and she never was mad at me for coming, nah, telling her. One night, I went to attend a church in Boston from Pawtucket, because I live in Pawtucket. So I went with my friends to attend this church in Boston, and we got lost from Boston. We ended up in Cape Cod. On the way, when we noticed that we were lost, it was after midnight. And when we started coming back to go to Pawtucket, we almost ran out of gas. Because I knew my aunt is in New Bedford, and I knew that she was not gonna be mad for me to knock on her door at midnight or after midnight, I told my friends, let's go to New Bedford, let's stop in New Bedford and go ask my aunt for money to buy gas to get to Pataki. And my friends were hesitant because they're like, oh, it's over, it's overnight. She's going to be mad. She's going to yell at us. I'm like, no, let's go. And then when I went, this is after her husband had passed. When I went, I knocked, and she asked who he was, and she came to the door. When she realized it was me, she opened it. No reactions. I explained what happened, and she gave me the money. I never forget that. The reason why we got lost is because I was like, I don't have a sense of directions. And I used to, there was no GPS at that time, but I knew how to come to New Bedford because my aunt was here. And the reason why I got to her house is because there was a pink house on a corner of County Street. Is it County Street? And Bedford Street. I didn't even know her address, the house address. I just got there. And all the time I got there, I always prayed that that house was still there, the house was still with the same color and not changed because I would miss it. But I just wanted to say this. Pastor mentioned it last night. Her address has changed. I don't need to have that pink house anymore. And that's why I share with you guys. I told you the encouragement. Make your friend God.
Amen.
As Boboy said, that long list, our grief, our pain did not start the day my aunt died. My grief and all of your grief started when she started getting sick. It's been a long ride. And you're gonna need it to make God your friend. As Titi said, it hasn't hit her yet. It probably didn't hit a lot of us. It will hit. And after today, we're gonna separate, we're gonna go home. We're all going to be alone at one point, and we're going to feel it. I encourage you guys, read your Bible. Make God your friend, and let God guide you, lead you, comfort you, because that's how my aunt lived her life. And as Pastor mentioned last night too, that's the legacy she lived.
Praise the Lord. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because Jesus lives, I can face tomorrow. May all of us today make our decision to accept Jesus as our personal Savior. Because He lives, let us sing with me. I know, oh, He holds the future.
because we live. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. That greatest child can face uncertain days because he lived.
Hallelujah.
Because he lived, I can face tomorrow. Because he lived, all fear is gone. Because we live, let us stand and sing together the last song. And when I pray, I cross the river, I find no more in me. And as I stand, because he lived, I can face tomorrow. I can face tomorrow. Because he lived, all fear is gone. Because I know, oh, he holds the future.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see you all here. I know she's smiling. It is a great honor to stand before you and talk about our sister, Mrs. Spencer. She one time told me, "Why don't you just call me Lita like everybody? You know you can do that." I said, "Well, some of you, I just cannot go on the first name basis." And it stayed there. What a wonderful person Mrs. Spencer was. I thank our Heavenly Father for the opportunity and the privilege that have been mine in meeting and knowing Mrs. Spencer for so many years. I loved her voice and her demeanor, her calm demeanor. I would tell her I'm jealous of that voice because I speak too loud. So when you speak softly, I tend to say, gee, I wish it were, I could have that voice, but she was special. She was a sweet and humble lady, a woman of very few words. We thank God for her life and for so much she has taught along the journey in her own quiet way. She showed God's love through her actions, like spoiling us privately with her special goodies in the fellowship hall, concerned that we were working too hard, taking care of everyone else, and would miss out on her specials, our favorite. go right in the corner and give it to us like a special mom. She would inquire about the church's needs and would always be ready to give her support. A faithful servant of the Lord indeed. She loved God with all her heart and loved the church, and her love was sincere and genuine. She took any ministry the Lord called her to very seriously and committed herself to the fullest, doing her very best in pleasing God. When on the church board a few years back, she'd approach me after every meeting with questions, wanting to understand all that is going on, wanted clarifications on some issues presented so that she would carry out her responsibilities and fulfill her purpose. She enjoyed being in the choir, looked forward to going, and was faithful to her participation in every choir practice, Sunday singing, and special event. When Mrs. Spencer greeted you, her beautiful smile for sure let you know that she was happy to see you. Her sweet spirit was very evident and unique. She will be greatly missed among us, but we know that to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. Amen. We have been blessed. She's gone from our sight, but will always be in our hearts forever. So we say, Te logo, our sister, and we'll see you soon. We love you and rest in peace.
Simplest way I could say it is, when I saw Cousin Leita, you saw Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Bible talks about the fruit of the Spirit and goodness and gentleness, kindness. Very humble, very unassuming. That's God. And I want to encourage you too, this whole family and all the different branches just that I know, that grace, that meekness, is on all of you. So thank you, Lord, for the time we had until we see her again. Bless the Lord. I dreamed of a city called glory, so bright and so fair. When I entered the gates, I cried, holy. The angels all met me there. They carried me from mansion to mansion. Oh, and all the sights I saw, but then I said, I want to see Jesus, the one who died for me. I bowed on my knees and cry, holy, holy, holy.
holy. I clap my hands and sing glory. Glory to the Son of God. I sing glory to the Son. I enter the gates of that city. Oh, my loved ones, all knew, they all knew me well, and laid to me down the street. Sights much too many to tell, and I saw Abraham, Jacob, Kaji, and Isaac. I spoke with Mark and with Timothy.
Did you know that's what Timothy?
I want to see Jesus, the only one who died.
In Jesus. Our hope is in the one who came and died for us to bring salvation to all mankind. Today I would like to consider the word of God in the book of Luke chapter 7 verse 11 to 15. St. Luke chapter 7 verses 11 to 15, the word of God says, Soon afterward, Jesus went to a town called Nain, and his disciples and a large crowd went along with him. As he approached the town gate, a dead person was being carried out, and a large crowd was following. When the Lord saw the mother, the widow, his heart went out to her, and he said to the widow, "Don't cry." Then he went up and touched the bier they were carrying him on, and the bier stood still. He said, "Young man, I say to you, get up." The dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. Father, I pray that you use your word to touch and to talk to us. In Jesus' name, amen. As Jesus traveled with his disciples up from the Sea of Galilee, they came at last to this small town called Nain. This town was located 25 miles away from Capernaum. A sorrowful woman who gave birth to only one son was now mourning the death of the son. Many people from the town attended her boy's funeral. The mourners encountered Jesus just when he had entered the gate of the city, and the funeral group was headed in the direction of the cemetery. This episode brings to us the reality that life is short and uncertain, that it doesn't matter our age, soon or later, all of us are going to die. What is life? James wrote. He said, "You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes." It is sometimes said that nothing is certain in life except death and taxes. But that is not wholly true. A clever man with a good lawyer can find a way around most, if not all, of his taxes, but no one escapes that. As George Shawn remarks, he said, "The statistics on death have not changed. One out of one person dies." And this was what happened with the son of this widow we read in the Gospel of Luke today. The scripture said that he died. Being a widow is always difficult for a woman, and this was especially true in those days. This poor woman already buried her husband, and now, sadly, she was about to bury her only son. She had experienced two major emotional losses with the death of her husband and now her only son. Unlike today, women could not earn a living. She did not have a social security or employment opportunities in her world. In losing her son, this woman had lost everything. She lost her hope for any kind of successful life. Who would support her now that the men in her family were gone? Many people came to the funeral of the young man. Family and friends came to support this grieving widow in her time of great need. Also present in this group of women were some ladies who were hired to cry. It was common practice in those days to hire professional mourners whose job was to weep, wane, and wail loudly at wakes and funerals. This was the tradition in Israel. They did not have really any word of comfort for this broken-hearted widow. They were simply there doing their jobs. The scripture let us know that Jesus was entering the town at that very moment that the crowd was moving in the direction to the cemetery, and the Lord saw the widow and his heart went out to her. "Don't cry," he said to the sad, weeping mother. The suffering of that widow touched Jesus, and he spoke with compassion to her as he took charge of the situation. Jesus did not hesitate. He walked up to the center of this crowd of grievers, right up to the grieving mother. He spoke to her, saying very simply, "Don't cry." It sounds like a contradiction for Jesus to say that when he himself cried at the death of his friend Lazarus. Jesus knew that the widow's pain was real. When you are grieving, your pain is real, and Jesus knows your pain. The scripture says that there is time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven, according to Solomon. Solomon wrote, "A time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance." Yes, Jesus knew that there was a time for that widow to cry. And cry is something very important. We heard some men saying, "Oh, if you are a man, you do not cry." That is not true. A time for people to see your tears. There is a time for people to see your tears. It is not a signal of weakness, but a sign we are human beings who have emotion. Someone wrote, "There is a sacredness in tears. They are not the mark of weakness, but of power. They speak more eloquently than 10,000 tongues. They are the messenger of overwhelming grief, of deep contrition, and of unspeakable love." But Jesus said to the widow, "Don't cry. Don't cry." Why did he do this? Because according to the word of God, his heart went out to her. Jesus had compassion for this widow. The scripture says that then Jesus, upon reaching the body, touched the bier, and he spoke these words, "Young man, I say to you, get up." The action of Jesus were highly unusual. First of all, he touched the bier that was a movable frame on which a coffin or corpse is placed before burial. This would have made him ceremonially unclean. Jesus knew that according to the law in Israel, you should not touch a dead body. And he went and touched. Why? Because the one who has all the power to bring life to someone who is dead has the power to make everything also clean. He tells this dead young man, "Get up. Get up." When we lose our hope, when we come to a time that we know that there is nothing we can do. I want to challenge all of you who are in this sanctuary to continue to trust God. Because nothing is impossible for Jesus to do. Can you imagine the onlookers when suddenly, at the command of Jesus, the dead man sat up and began to talk? Jesus, what he did at that exact moment was to cancel the funeral. He canceled the funeral. No more need of mourners anymore. If it was in our days, he was maybe the people who worked at Sunday funeral would say, what's going on? We are without job today. Without job. And the word of God let us know that at that moment, everything like stopped. I do believe that for some of those who were there, the question is, who is this man? Who is this man who has the power to cancel a funeral? The word of God says that Jesus, in another occasion, Jesus received someone came to Jesus, a messenger, who said, Mary and Martha needs you. They want you to go to the village because the one that you love is sick. And they were referring to Lazarus. And the word of God says that Jesus decided to stay for a couple days where he was. And when he got finally to where Martha and Mary lived, the word of God says that they came to Jesus and they said to Jesus, if you were here, our brother would not die. First Martha and after Mary repeat the same words. And the question was, where you buried him? And they brought Jesus to the place. And the word of God says that Jesus called the dead out of the grave. And the one who was dead came out of the grave. My brothers and sisters, dear friends, I want you to understand that all of us are dead in our sins and transgressions, and we fall short of the glory of God. The Apostle Paul wrote these words about our condition before and after we have accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior. He wrote, as for you, you were dead in your transgression and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of the world and of the rulers of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. What this portion of the scripture tells us is that even though that widow didn't have any hope, the hope was in Jesus. And for all of us who are far from God's presence, I want you to make sure that your life, it is in Jesus' hands. Open your life to Jesus. Because he wants you to understand that salvation is only through Jesus Christ. In the same way that Jesus spoke to that dead person, the Holy Spirit speaks to us who are far from God's presence, who are dead in our sins and transgression, telling us, repent and turn to Jesus. And Paul wrote, the grace of God had appeared, bringing salvation to all mankind. The message is not for our sister Lydia Spencer, because she's not here anymore. The message today is for you. There was an appointment in heaven that today you would be in this sanctuary and you would be able to listen a servant of God to tell you that you need Jesus. You need Jesus. And the best decision ever that we can make is to say yes to Jesus. We don't know how many years that young man lived after that. The only thing that we know, according to the scripture, is that he sat down and he started to talk. What he said, I don't know. Did he have the opportunity to speak about heaven? We don't know. The scriptures also said that after Jesus' resurrection, a lot of people came out from the grave. There was a massive resurrection. A lot of people, what they said, I do believe that they were saying to those who saw them that they needed to place their life in Jesus because he is God. And the only way for us to be in the presence of the Father is through Jesus Christ. Really, the scripture doesn't tell us all the details. But John, in his letter, let us know that everything that was written about Jesus was for us to come to understanding that Jesus is the Son of God and that believing in him, we may have life, everlasting life. That Jesus is God and we need him. The greater assurance for our sister Lydia, Lita Spencer, was that the one who rose again from the dead was there waiting for her and saying, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Now you are home." May God bless you. And may God help all of us to understand our need, that in our sins and transgressions, but the one who has all the power can bring us and give us life, eternal life. God bless you.
You know, I've always known Mrs. Spencer, but I really didn't get to know her till she joined the choir. And I was thinking about one day how Pastor Orlando had the choir, this part of the choir singing, while our half over here, we had to wait till our turn. So Mrs. Spencer was sitting there, you know, as she always does, and I was behind her. And one day I was like, talking real loud and this and that. And then Miss Calm Cool Collected Lydia Spencer turned around and she looked at me. She didn't say anything and she didn't cut me a dirty look. But just the fact that Mrs. Spencer turned around told me to be quiet. No, that's what exactly. No, you've never seen her turn around because she really didn't say anything. And I never heard her sing. I know her lips were moving and all that, but I've never heard her sing. But you know what, though? Mrs. Spencer, and I want the family to take this, you know, to heart and as well as the congregation, she had a servant's attitude. Amen. She had a servant's mentality. She didn't demand to be up front singing. No, she didn't demand to be a prima donna. She didn't demand to lead in prayer. She came to serve the Lord, no matter what it was, just like they said earlier with the communion cups and little things that she did around here that we don't know about, because I didn't even know about the communion cups, but I knew about other things. No, she was a perfect example of what it is to serve the Lord without getting all the praise and being out front and trying to be cute. So if there's anything we learn from Mrs. Spencer, is how to be a servant of Almighty God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
Precious Father, we thank thee for the life of Mrs. Spencer, Father, Lord. Lord, she just set a great example for all of us, Lord, especially her family, Lord, what it means to truly serve the Lord, Lord. She was humble, Father, Lord. She was very, very humble, Father. Quiet. But she was loud in spirit.
Yes.
Precious Lord, I pray for this family, Lord, that you would give them grace and mercy, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you would give them comfort, Father, Lord, as they mourn the loss, but yet celebrate the life of their mom, their grandmother, sister, Father, Lord, servant of our church, friends of our church, Father. a member of our church. Father, Lord, we know that she is with you, Lord. We know right now that she's wearing the crown of righteousness, Father, Lord. Yes. She worked so hard, Father, Lord, and now she's getting her just rewards, Father, Lord. And we thank you, Father, Lord, for the promise that you give, that you are going to give the same thing to us long as we remain in Jesus Christ, Father, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that this family, Lord, there's anyone that doesn't know the Lord, that soon the day will come to know you in a special way, Lord. So, Lord, watch over this family today. Protect their legacy, Father, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that this family will bring them even closer to you, my Lord. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. If some of your family didn't have the opportunity to come to this time of celebration of life, I want to let you know that they can go on Facebook and watch this service, ICN, International Church of Nazarene. The service is online and you can watch that. May God bless you. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Surely mercy right beside.